Requiem for a Dream, the one movie where you've probably heard the theme song of the movie, but not seen the actual movie. I've heard many great things about Requiem for a Dream, so I had very high hopes going into the movie. Also, I've heard many people talk about how disturbing it is. If you go to Complex, they have a top 60 most disturbing movie list, and they put Requiem for a Dream at number 9. To give you an idea of how high that is, the Human Centipede 1 doesn't even make the top 60 list, and Human Centipede 2 only makes number 45. Even the controversial movie, a Serbian film, only makes number 15. Requiem for a Dream is 9. So seeing how this movie surpassed many movies that even I can barely get through, I was really curious about it and it kind of made me want to watch it. And let me just tell you, this movie is incredibly disturbing, but for different reasons than most of the movie are on the list. I could film a ton of gross sequences and scenes and just clip them all together, but if that's all the film brings to the table, it has no substance. It can't really be that much more disturbing than you make it out to be. When you care about the characters in a movie, it makes you a lot more sad and depressed when things don't go their way. Requiem for a Dream brings us a highly disturbing movie without including the gore and shock value that most so-called disturbing movies do. It brings you characters that you care about, a realistic plotline, and a satisfying yet unfortunate ending. As I go through and explain the plot of the movie, I will be trying to tackle as many points as I can and try to explain as much as I can possible to help you guys understand the ending and what happens to each of the characters. With enough being said, let's get right into the plot. Requiem for a Dream starts off by introducing Sarah Goldfarb, played by Ellen Burstyn, who is an old widow living alone in an apartment in Brighton Beach, New York City. She is addicted to watching infomercials and has a goal of being on TV one day. Out of nowhere, the TV turns off and you meet her son, Harry Goldfarb, played by Jared Leto. Harry is a heroin addict who has a goal of opening a clothing store with his girlfriend, Marion Silver, played by Jennifer Connelly. Harry is stealing his mother's TV so he can sell it for drug money. We are also introduced to Tyrone Love, played by Marlon Wayans, who is Harry's best friend. Tyrone has a goal of getting out of the gang scene and receive approval from his dead mother. The two friends roll the TV all around the area until they get to a small shop, which he sells the TV for a small amount of cash. Then we see Harry do some heroin. The scene cuts back to Sarah, who seems to be buying her TV back from the place where Harry just sold it. When the dude asks her why she doesn't call the cops on her son, Sarah responds that Harry is all she has left. When Sarah gets home, she receives a phone call that said she was randomly selected to be on the TV show, and that they will send her a form in the mail to fill out. And this all fulfills her dream of being on the infomercial. She goes to her closet and pulls out a red dress which she wore at Harry's graduation. Unfortunately, she does not fit in the red dress anymore as she is too big. She also dyes her hair red in preparation for being on the show. Wanting to fit in the red dress, she decides to go on a diet. And trust me guys, I've tried that myself. It will definitely work. Yeah, it'll work. It won't work. I'm telling you now, it probably won't work. Next, it cuts back to Tyrone, Marion, and Harry. They are making drugs and talking about their game plan for selling. Tyrone says he's got a sweet connection, which they are preparing for. Later that day, we see Marion and Harry looking at pictures of the store they want to buy for their clothing business. We also get a scene of Marion in the bathroom snorting some cocaine, which makes her feel amazing. Then it cuts back to Sarah, failing at the diet. She decides to go outside and one of her friends mentioned that there are pills she can take to relieve her of her hunger and take away her appetite for food. Also, the mailman walks by and Sarah receives a TV application form. In excitement, she goes into her apartment and fills out the form. Simultaneously, we see Tyrone about to do some dealing where he will buy some drugs which they sell for more. That's basically what drug dealing is, guys, you know? You buy something, you sell it for more, but just with drugs. Can't be that illegal. Also, we get an important clip of Harry hallucinating Marion at the end of a boardwalk, and he runs up to her where she turns around and smiles. That is important for later in the story. Sarah's feeling so bad at the diet that she can't sleep. In desperation, she decides to call her friend and asks her for the number of the doctor who can get her on those anti-hunger pills. She calls the doctor and gets prescribed to amphetamines. The pills essentially work and cause her to rapidly rapidly lose weight. Meanwhile, we see Marion getting all dressed up and putting on makeup. When Harry questions her on what she's doing, she tells him that she's going out for dinner with a psychiatrist named Arnold. She can't stop doing these or else Arnold will tell her parents back in Florida, which means they will stop paying for her apartment and stop giving her money. She goes out to eat with Arnold, and the dude is creepy as all get out. And the way he talks fast and the way he chews fast, you know, he's like, "So have you been?" "That's okay." Oh, it's so creepy, you know. I would rather be on the streets than take a meeting with that dude. I'm just being honest with you guys. Tyrone and Harry start dealing the drugs they bought earlier and start to build up a really good amount of cash. In fact, they are getting really close to being able to put a down payment on the business building. Meanwhile, Sarah is taking her pills and losing more and more weight. She is starting to rely on them more. We also get an important scene of Tyrone remembering when he was a kid with his mama, showing he still loves her a lot and wants to get her approval. With the drug business doing well, Harry visits his mom and tells her that he plans on buying her a new TV set for all the hassle he's caused. He told his mom that he has a business that's doing really well. "Yeah, mom, I have a dealing business. Let's just say I give people stuff. And it's going really well. I promise it's not drugs, mom. It's just candy. You can trust me on that one. It's just candy, mom." He also notices that his mom is jittering her teeth together and overly laughing and being very energetic. Harry knows this means that she is on medication and tells her she needs to quit or it will mess her up. Also, when she tells him that she's going to be on TV, Harry says, "So what?" and how that's no reason to be taking medications that will harm her. Unfortunately, in the next scene, we see Tyrone get stuck in a gang shootout with Angel, his gang overlord. Trying to escape, he gets caught by some police and arrested. Consequently, Harry has to spend nearly all the money they collected from dealing just to get Tyrone out on bail. While they walk from jail, Tyrone tells Harry that the local supply of heroin is now restricted, causing them to be unable to get any drugs. Tyrone does mention a guy named Big Tim who has mass amounts of heroin, however he only gives it up for sex. He is a major pimp who's obsessed with broads. Eventually, some good news comes. While Harry and Tyrone were chilling under the boardwalk, Tyrone says that Angel notified him that there is going to be a shipment of heroin coming from Florida, but it will be twice as expensive. Not having enough money, Harry suggests to his girlfriend Marion that she should sleep with the creepy psychiatrist Arnold to get some more money. Both being very needy addicts, she agrees and decides to do it. This scene is really disturbing, and you can see how she does not like it, as she even asks Arnold to turn off the lights before they have sex. The scene switches to showing Harry still at home, however it seemed to be showing his girlfriend and Arnold having sex on the TV. Even though it was all in his head, he took more heroin to make it go away. The scene cuts back to Marion, who is leaving Arnold's apartment, and she throws up. She felt that sick. With Marion receiving the money, Tyrone and Harry just have enough to buy some of that Florida heroin. So they go to the location where the Florida shipment of heroin is being sold. Unfortunately, it was too crowded and things went south quick, which left them both empty-handed. During this, Marion is fiending extremely badly and trashing the whole apartment looking for drugs. When Harry gets home and tells Marion that he came back empty-handed, she goes full rage mode at him. She had sex with Arnold just so they could get the supply of heroin, and it was all for nothing. Out of desperation, Harry calls Tyrone, asking him for the number of the pimp dude who likes broads. Tyrone gives him Big Tim's phone number, which he writes down for Marion. Then we see Sarah increasing her intake of pills. She started by taking one per meal, and now she is taking two per meal. She starts to become afraid of her refrigerator, which is now shaking and starts jumping and making very loud sounds. She also starts hallucinating that she's on the TV show, and out of nowhere, the TV host hops out of the TV. However, it's all in her head. Eventually, the whole crowd starts laughing at her and making fun of her, and they all start yelling at once that she needs to be taking more pills, more pills, more pills, more pills. Wait, I shouldn't be saying that. No, don't take more pills. No pills, no pills, no pills. In fear, she runs outside and goes to the metro, where she heads to the TV show headquarters. Everyone thinks she's crazy on the way, not only because she looks rough, but because she is talking and acting very odd. In real life, it can take up to a year before you actually get communicated back after you've applied to be on a TV show. So it's not surprising that she hasn't received anything from the show. Also, she's not in the best mental state, and a authorities take note on that, so security escorts her out and takes her to a hospital where they try to help her. However, unfortunately, it's not just a hospital, it's a mentally insane hospital. Big difference between the two. Tyrone and Harry leave New York City to go to Florida for a few days, where they will be able to buy more heroin and get resupplied up. Angel calls Marion to tell her this, however, she's unable to wait a few days. In desperation, she decides to call Big Tim, where she sells her body for some drugs. Big Tim offers that she could come to a big party on Sunday and get even more, however, she rejects. She even tells him she's not an addict, however, Big Tim knows she's lying. Going back to Tyrone and Harry's arm is turning black from all the heroin shots he's given himself. It gets so bad that they have to delay their trip to Florida and stop at a hospital so Harry can get some help. Unfortunately, the doctor could tell his issues were due to heroin shots, so he calls the cops, getting them arrested without doing any treatment. Switching back to Sarah, she is now in the medical bed where doctors are starting to do various things to her. Harry calls Marion from prison, where she begs him to stay and come home that night. Although Harry is in prison, in tears, he promises her that he will, even though he knows that he will not really be able to. Marion also decides to go to Big Tim's party, where she is subjected to extremely horrible sex acts that are torturous and painful, but by doing this, she scores a big amount of heroin. It flashes back to Tyrone and Harry in line to get checked if they are capable of working. When Tyrone is up, he forgets to say yes sir, and the guards yell the N-word at him and beat him to the ground. Harry is next, where they notice his arm and gets him to medical help. Sarah is now getting shock therapy, which leaves her in the mental state of a vegetable. Harry is unconscious and gets his arm amputated, where he imagines the boardwalk scene which we talked about at the beginning, but this time Marion disappears, and when he steps backward, the boardwalk abruptly ends, causing him to fall down the pit. This represents a dream of him owning a business with Marion exiting his mind, leaving him empty and depressed inside. He then wakes up and realizes that Marion will not come for him, and that he is doomed. At the beginning, Marion turned around and smiled back at the boardwalk, but now she's not there, indicating she is no longer in his life and that his dream of them owning a business together is forever lost, leaving him sad and depressed. He knows Marion has gone into the prostitution business for heroin because he is the one who introduced it to her. The doctor hears him mutter Marion under his breath, and she tries to convince him that they'll get her to come visit him. However, he tells her that she won't and starts crying as the camera pans out. It also reveals he's missing an arm. This is an extremely depressing scene to watch. Here, I'm gonna show it to you guys, but just warning to you guys, it's pretty sad.
It's all right. Don't worry, you're in a hospital. Who's that? She'll be sent for. She'll come.
No.
No?
No, she won't.
She'll come.
So yep, pretty sad. Harry is crying because he knows he will have to live with the consequences of his choices and drug addiction. He also feels guilty because he was the one who begged Marion to sleep with her psychiatrist, even though she clearly did not want to. He also wrote down the number to Big Tim and gave it to Marion, leading her down a very dark path. For Sarah, we see her friends visit her and they're shocked to see what happened to her. At the very end, all four main characters are lying down curled up. The camera shows Harry laying down in the hospital bed crying. Marion is smiling, then grabs her drugs from her pockets and hugs them while laying on the couch curled up. Tyrone is laying in his prison bed imagining his mother while curled up. And Sarah is laying down in the mental institution like a vegetable and she also curls up. Then Sarah imagines that she's actually on the TV show and Harry is there engaged to Marion and they hug, which was her dream all along to be on that show and for Harry to be successful, and that is how the movie ends. Now to my review. Each of the four main characters has a goal which none of them end up achieving. Each goal ends up falling short due to their drug addiction. Everyone lost. This movie is scary because it's reality. Many people every day have lives like these four characters and we never think about it. Drug addiction has always been an issue, but this movie reminds you of it and how dangerous they actually are to your body and to your their whole life in general. I saw a YouTube comment say one lost her sanity, one lost his freedom, one lost her dignity, and one lost his dream. And I think that's a great way of putting how the movie ended. Also, Tyrone is the only one who has a chance of turning his life around after he gets out of prison. For Harry, he always wanted to open a business with Marion, however that will not happen anymore because he's in prison. With his dream being lost in his own mind, he has no motivation to even live anymore. Although he could go back to Marion once he's out of prison, Marion has no desire for him anymore and is happy with where she's at, hence why she was smiling at the end while hugging the drugs. Big Tim knows Marion will keep coming back for the drugs. Harry is also partially the reason she got into prostitution, so he can only feel guilty for it. Marion smiling at the end also indicates that she will not be going back for Harry because she has found a way of clenching her drug addiction. To get to the more logistical stuff, all the acting in this movie is phenomenal. Jennifer Connelly did an amazing job playing as Marion, and in fact, I remember how good she did in Beautiful Mind, so my expectations for her in this movie were actually a lot higher, and she actually exceeded those expectations. I've also seen a lot of Jared Leto movies like, you know, Panic Room, you got Fight Club, you got quite a few of them, and I actually think this is my favorite Jared Leto movie so far, surprisingly. In fact, Fight Club's a really good movie, and I still think that this movie surpasses that in my opinion. Even Ellen Burstyn as Sarah was so good. She actually got nominated for an Oscar, and unfortunately she didn't win, but that still shows you how good of a job she did. Marlon Wayans as Tyrone, he also did an incredible job. All four of the main characters did super good, along with even like the creepy psychiatrist did a good job of being creepy. Big Tim, the actor for Big Tim, did so good. Like when Marion knocks on his door and he calls her Maid Marion, and then you just get a close up of his mouth, and the way he says that is so creepy. In fact, I'll play it right now.
Maid Marion, welcome.
That scene also shows you how well this film is directed and how good the cinematography is. Aaron Aronsky does a great job at directing this movie. It's very impressive. I need to do some more of his movies. If you guys want me to do like Mother with an exclamation mark or Pi, there's a few I need to see yet, so just leave them down below if you want me to do any other of his movies. But yeah guys, the acting was really good in this movie. The way it was shot, like the way they took drugs, it showed you like them pop it in their mouth and like their blood, it shows their pupils get big. Just the way this movie is filmed is incredible. I'm going to give Requiem for a Dream a 92%. I really like this movie, guys, if you can't tell. I thought it was incredible. So guys, if you made it to the end of this video, as always, thank you so much for watching. Subscribe if you like what I'm doing. I really work hard on these videos. I mean, this script took me about 5 to 6 hours, surprisingly, just by how complicated the movie is. Tusk was a lot easier to do. This one took me about 6 hours to write the script to this movie. It took me a long time. This is actually my third time recording, because I thought I talked too fast the first few times around. So yeah, I've worked really hard on this video. So if you guys do like it, please subscribe. Leave in the comments any suggestions you guys have below. And yeah, I'll see you in the next video. And I hope you guys all have a great day. And I am out. Peace.